Generation Y, also known as the Millennials, are a generation who have chosen differently when it comes to traditional life markers by delaying marriage, children, and the purchasing of their first home. This generation are currently in their family-forming years, now pursuing leadership roles. They're often the parents of Generation Alpha and are highly innovative, technological, and social as a generation. So joining me today to discuss our latest research about Generation Y is social researcher and director of strategy at McCrindle and my fellow Gen Y, Grant Dusting. Grant, welcome back to the podcast.
Oh, hey, Ash. It's great to be here. I've really enjoyed the last few episodes with Mark on the baby boomers and Gen X. So it's a pleasure to talk about our generation, Gen Y.
Yeah, no one with more, well, no other people in the team really, apart from the other Gen Ys, I think, who can speak on the same authority as us, because we both have the privilege of sharing these insights from the platform and on stage. But of course, anytime, I don't know if you do this, but when I do, like when there's a Gen Y stat, I'm like, and how do I feel about that? As part of this generation, we've got this kind of unique authority. And I think for us, you know, as Gen Y, those born between 1980 and 1994, that places people of our generation today in their mostly 30s and early 40s. And Grant, I'd be keen to hear from your perspective just around what you would say are either like societal events or even transformative technologies that have shaped our generation or, you know, have shaped you.
Yeah, so Gen Y, so like you said, from 1980 to 1994, making the youngest Gen Y is about to turn 30 and the oldest Gen Y is in their early 40s. I think the big social markers, the ones that come to mind initially are September 11, so September 11, 2001. I think the 80s and 90s represented this era of globalization and was part of the American century, which was the 20th century. And that didn't end in 2001 with the World Trade Center incidents, but I think it was definitely a confronting moment for everyone in the world. But I remember where I was when I saw that on the news as a school kid. And I think it did definitely bring a lot of kind of social and political things into focus around our perceived safety of the modern world, the Middle East, and kind of a new era of global terrorism being front and center. So I think that was a big marker. Quite a sobering or confronting one. But I also think of, in 1997, the death of Princess Diana as a key social marker as well, and especially for the UK and parts of the world that are part of the Commonwealth, including Australia, obviously. And Princess Diana was a huge social icon in Australia particularly. So there's been documentaries about that. So I think that was a big marker as well, 1997. And probably the third that comes to mind is 1999 coming into the new millennium. There was that optimism and excitement of, wow, a new millennium, and technology was on the rise and the internet was kind of getting into full swing. And then there was the whole thing about the Y2K bug, where all of our computers kind of implode because they were working on two digits, 99 as the year, and then flicking to 00, would they all get confused and think we were back to 1900? So, which didn't eventuate, but those were a few kind of social markers that I thought of.
Yeah, I would definitely agree with those, especially the September 11 attacks. And yeah, like many people of our generation, you know, being quite young, but really remembering that moment in history and changing travel. I mean, we probably didn't know what travel was like before that event, but we hear the stories of how much more relaxed it was, and now all the security measures that are in place that have just become a part of our lives. And yeah, I think for me as well, when we think about technologies that have transformed different generations, I think that the main one that I guess most people would think of and comes to mind is the iPhone and all the devices that are in it. But iconic, I remember having iconic, absolutely. And for Gen Z, you know, they their first phone would have been some iteration of the iPhone, but for our generation it was the Nokia flip phone or I had a hot pink Motorola one at one point, you know, where nice. the only function was like to play games and make calls, but mainly text. And then later iterations of those phones, like you had a camera, which was terrible quality, but Would you agree with that? Different phones, but older versions of it?
Absolutely. The Nokia 3210 was my first phone, which was a hand-me-down from my mum. I remember when she got her first work mobile phone, which was an earlier Nokia. And then I think the 3210 was maybe her second or third. And a few years later, she got a new one. And I think I was in mid-high school at that point, and I was deemed old enough to get a mobile phone. But yeah, so I think when I think of tech that shaped us, I think the Gen Ys were the first generation where mobile phones, personal computers and laptops were really shaping the working context. And I think I remember going to university in kind of the mid to late 2000s. And I think my first year I was just using, you know, pen and notepad, but I remember the really cool kids and probably the richer kids were there with their laptops, but that was still a bit novel, even at that time. So I think that would be, there'd be comparisons there to kind of what workplaces were going through as well in terms of the technology. So, and that totally changed, you know, within a few short years, right? I think within schools, laptops and computers became a lot more commonplace and more accessible. And so, yeah, but in terms of tech, I think of the World Wide Web just gaining in prominence in the 90s and kind of 2000s, and mobile phones and computers becoming much more mainstream, I think, in workplaces and households.
Yeah, absolutely. When we did this, the exploration of these insights for our virtual event a few weeks ago, I was emceeing that, and I put up on the slide like a millennial starter kit, because I am a millennial, and it was kind of, sometimes I see it on Instagram or Facebook where different generations, and it just gives a bit of a window into those transformative games and even like foods and those fads. And on the Millennial Starter Kit, I had Pokemon cards, Tamagotchis, Furbies, the show Round the Twist. I don't know if you watched that in Australian primary schools, but iconic, I definitely did. Yep. MSN Messenger, Ovaltinis, those little like lollies in the canteen, Healthy Harold Vans, and Dragon Ball Z. There were just some of those things like paints this weird kind of moment in time or decade in time or so for our generation. So I think that's the power as well when we talk about these things, where other hopefully millennials listen and go, oh yeah, I did watch Round the Twist, or maybe parents of the millennials go, oh yeah, I remember when my kids were into Furbies or whatever it might be. So fascinating to kind of look at generations in this way. But in this report, as well as kind of looking at, or in this virtual event, you know, I made this joke about the starter kit, but then we delved into a lot of data and insights about the different generations. And in the millennial kind of infographic and expose, part of what we included there was, of course, their top hopes, or our top hopes and fears. And the number one top hope that the millennials in this study that we ran said they have for their life is to have full financial freedom and independence. That was followed by wanting to travel and see the world and pursue interests and hobbies. And honorable mention that own their own home came down in at number 5. Grant, did any of these, or the ordering of these top hopes and fears, surprise you at all?
Well, the fact that we found Gen Y's top hopes are to have full financial freedom and independence, those things you mentioned, travel and see the world and pursue interests and hobbies, to me that makes total sense, because Gen Y as a generation has largely lived through very prosperous economic times, particularly in our formative years in the 80s, 90s and the first part of the 2000s. I think we've seen in that time the many benefits of globalization. We've seen the emergence of China and Asia as kind of manufacturing powerhouses. So really, as well as the cost of air travel actually falling in relative terms, which is really, there's a stat I saw, some analysis done by the Atlantic publication, who said that roughly 50 airline, the cost of airfares fell roughly 50% between 1980 and 2010. So over about 30 years actually fell, whereas everything else has gone up and up. And we know from our research we've done that the cost of housing, for example, has increased by 5 to 15 times the rate of kind of inflation, or the average incomes in that roughly the same time period. So the cost of housing has gone up and up and up. The cost of travel has actually come down, both in relative and in actual terms. So I think there's a few things playing into that. Financial freedom, I think we see the world largely in economic terms. That economic paradigm is really strong, and I think this generation has been shaped very much in that consumer mindset, for better or for worse, and often sadly for worse at times. But that has been, I think, a defining paradigm for Generation Y, to think of ourselves as consumers and in economic terms. And so it makes sense then that people see financial freedom, financial success, as the gateway to a good life. So to me, that made a lot of sense, and actually is consistent with other research we've conducted in the last 12 months for one of our clients, in fact, Insignia Financial, where we developed the Financial Freedom Index to understand the aspirations of modern Australians and to kind of take a collective pulse of how people are thinking about financial freedom and their aspirations. And that information is all in the public domain, so people can Google the Financial Freedom Report and look at the work we did there, which is really interesting. And actually, it complements the findings in this latest study we've done.
Yeah, it's really great reflections there. And yeah, I think about it again from my own experience, and just even growing up, like social media, I'm on the younger end of the Gen Y years, and kind of social media came into my life like when I was leaving high school. And even to see like just how accessible other people's travel vlogs and photos are. And like you said, flights seem expensive today, but comparatively, they're actually, I guess, a little bit more affordable than they might have been in the past. And it's just, travel is so accessible. And I also was just reflecting as you were answering there that when I started at McCrindle, like just a casual decade ago almost, at the time,
no way, we were talking, don't look that old, Ashley.
Thank you, Grant. Thank you for that. I feel that old, if that's you know, any consolation to anyone. But I definitely think when I started here, the media commentary that we were delivering at the time, or that Mark and the team were delivering, was around millennials and being locked out of the housing market. And that's kind of been that whole millennials, you know, love smash dabo. And that was a few years ago now, even that comment. And I think what's happened is you just hear those things and they stick in your mind. But over time, the millennials have gotten older, and a lot of them have entered the housing market. So it's interesting as well, I think, that reordering, maybe, like, it'd be fascinating 10 years ago how these might have differed for this generation, of course, in a different life stage. But now a lot of them have had kids, and they've moved out of the inner city, and they've moved away because of affordability. And even a lot of my, again, just anecdotally, I know a lot of my friends have entered the housing market. They've left the cities, they've made the move to the regions to pursue that lifestyle, if they started a family. So it's fascinating, I guess, that life stage that underpins some of these hopes and fears.
Yeah, definitely. And in fact, the research I mentioned before, one of the TV channels that picked it up and ran a segment, they had used the headline "Make Memories, Not Mortgages." Was their take on the research? And I think that is, although that's, you know, a snazzy media headline, it is a neat kind of forward summary of some of the key insights we found. But I think that's all well and good for the youngest of the emerging generations, the Gen Zs, who are only just kind of entering the workforce and having some disposable income. Definitely they're cashing in, making memories, wanting those experiences. But then the Gen Ys, as you say, they're in their family forming years, either thinking seriously about their careers and life and what they want, and thinking about how they can build for that financially. Or they've already started having families and then are hit with the realities of those costs and the helpfulness of being settled in a place. And so, sure, they might want to make memories, but a mortgage is often seen as a necessity for those things. So, so yes, I think there's a lot playing in there when it comes to the hopes of Gen Y. But I think that the fact that they're currently now in their family forming years, I think that does shape a lot of their current realities too.
Yeah. And another reality and another area that we kind of explored in this study was the workforce employee kind of landscape. And one of the questions we asked was around what attracts people to a particular job or a workplace. And then, of course, as we did the whole report, segmented by a generation. And when we segmented it by the Gen Ys, we found that the top attractor to a workplace is to have flexible working hours. 73% said that was most important, but that was equally tied with convenient location. And that came above other aspects around just above leadership and career progression and remuneration and other factors that was reordered for different generations. But again, thinking about this generation at this moment in time where they are in that family forming life stage, as you've just described, do you think that that's playing into this key attractor for them around flexibility?
I think so. And I think the Gen Ys, given that they're in their 30s and early 40s, they're really in many of them who are in that kind of the daily grind of trying to carve out a career. And so we know that there is that culture of kind of overwork. And I think we're living in an era that has kind of glorified overwork. And I think the Gen Ys are a really interesting case study in that they've been shaped in this time. And now there's a bit of pushback. And I think for those who are going, wow, if I'm going to be slogging it out, doing kind of 40-hour plus weeks at work to try to pay the bills and to either set myself up or to set up my family, then I actually want to make sure that that is working for me. And so that flexibility, I think, plays into it there, because if you're spending so much time at work as a necessity, then you want that flexibility, and those things do really matter in addition to all the other things that are going on. So I think for those who are, so I've got my wife and I have a 1-year-old, a toddler or pre-toddler at home, Esther. So we're not yet in that kind of schooling age, but I know for many of our peers who are already at that age where they've got school age children, and this would be true for certainly the older Gen Ys, when we look at the average age of first time parents being in their early 30s, if they're now ferrying kids to and from school, they've got the extracurricular, whether it's sports or music that's after school or weekend sports. Weekend sports is huge, and particularly in Australia, it's probably the biggest kind of social phenomenon, I would say, is weekend sports. And so again, Gen Ys are living busy lives. Their personal and professional lives are busy. And for those, many of them now have families, is busy as well. They're trying to chase flexibility wherever they can, because just trying to make the best of their situation. So to me, that would explain that quest for flexibility.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think you alluded to it there, even in your answer about Gen Y being in that kind of career progression life stage. They're not that, you know, uni post-school pathway, new and entrant into the workforce anymore. They've got a decade probably or more of experience under their belt. And I think it's fascinating because, again, for a long time in the media, it was like millennials are lazy or entitled. And now we've kind of passed that on to probably the new emerging workforce, where it's like Gen Z are entitled and they want career progression instantly and have all these unrealistic expectations. You know, some of the stereotypes that might exist about them feel like, you know, we had a decade ago or so. But now we're talking about Gen Y as in some cases, you know, in leadership roles, in middle management, they've got that tenure. And what this study also uncovered is that they're quite a loyal generation. In fact, the most likely to say that they're likely to remain loyal to an organization or brand. And Grant, I know that we were kind of chatting about these insights when you were kind of reviewing some of the things we had written about this in our Generations Define report. You had some really interesting perspectives on that. I'd be keen to hear your thoughts and your reflections on this. I mean, I was a little bit surprised that Gen Y were the most loyal. Were you surprised as well?
Well, when I saw that stat that Gen Y were most likely to say they're going to remain loyal to a brand, yeah, I was initially surprised, because I thought, well, hang on, this is the era of choice and a global playing field when it comes to products and services. So we know that people want to find the best deal, and they can, because it's this global marketplace. So that was my initial reaction. But then the more I thought about it, the more it did make sense, actually, that just thinking that the last 10, 20 years, that where the Gen Ys have been shaped kind of as adults, or as young adults and then to adults, is we've been in this era of really strongly kind of a marketing era, and the era of brand, really, the concept of brand, where it's not just about goods and services, it's about companies are trying to sell an experience, and a lifestyle, and to kind of pitch themselves as not just a product, but the lifestyle that comes with it. So I think that's been a feature of the era that Gen Ys have been shaped in kind of their adult lives. In addition to that, we're living in the age of kind of social media and the internet. So again, the younger generations, Gen Z and now Gen Alpha, they're growing up with this from children. But for Gen Ys, I think the social media era was largely kind of shaping them firstly in their kind of, depending on where they are in the Gen Y kind of range, is probably in their late schooling and more in their kind of young adult years, being shaped by social media and the internet. So I think, again, we've been shaped in this era where companies are, we're interacting with them on social media, we're interacting with them on the internet, and they're seeking to build a story of their organization and their leader. So I think people are engaging with companies very differently to how they did decades ago. And I think the Gen Ys have been at the forefront of this, has really been their way of operating as they kind of are in their 20s, 30s and 40s. So it makes sense, because we see a lot of companies, it's not just a product or service, but it's about the brand and the following and the lifestyle, but also the leader and building that personal connection. So I think if you're building that personal connection, I mean, I think Apple and Steve Jobs is the obvious example that springs to mind, but we could go through almost any of the big companies, and I'm sure you could see this, that actually effective marketing now is about building that company story, so that the consumer feels like, oh, I've got a personal connection to this and I feel invested. And so if you feel invested, then naturally you're going to be more loyal. So yeah, I think there's a lot going on there, which is interesting, but that was some of my reflections.
Yeah, I think that's really great. And I would agree with that, even as a consumer, as a Gen Y consumer, around what marketing and brand stories and brand community building and how that's shifted, and how, like, yeah, you want to be a part of the movement or a part of the brand, and it's more than just the product. There's so much else going on that marketers and advertisers are strategically trying to communicate to consumers today. And I think as well, with regards to the workplace, I was just reflecting with Gen Z, I feel like, you know, the discourse that I see and that I hear about is through social media. It's often not like work hard and hustle. It's set your boundaries, and if you don't like it, you know, quiet quit or whatever it might be. And we can do a whole episode on, you know, the pros of setting boundaries, but the cons of that kind of discourse as well. But I'm just fascinated, I guess, to see how that continues to play out for Gen Z. Like, will they be at this point, like in 10 years, will we do this study again and see that Gen Z in that life stage that the Gen Ys are in now are going to exhibit loyalty after they've kind of moved through those early career years in terms of the workforce? But like you said, Grant, there, even your comments around the context for which organizations and brands are communicating and building customers, and there'll be even more choice in the future again. So as more brands kind of pop up and more products and more alternate services. So yeah, there's a few trends going on around life stage, around context, around workforce, around brands, but fascinating to see what similarities, you know, exist in a few years' time between the Gen Z and the Gen Ys.
Yeah, it definitely will be, because decision fatigue is real, right? I think we have so much choice now, but also it's overwhelming. So people, they don't want to feel like they have to shop around like for every single decision. You do your due diligence, but then you want to try to limit the number of choice you need to make, because you just don't have time to do all that research for every single thing. So I suspect that's part of it too, that the loyalty maybe is a bit pragmatic, that it's now we're overwhelmed with information. We can compare prices and products and services, but maybe it's just that sense of being overwhelmed with everything, that you're going to actually, I'm just going to try to find a good thing and then stick to it unless it's going catastrophically bad.
Yeah, absolutely. Something else we explored in this particular study was around qualities that different generations prefer and look for in their leaders. And we've definitely seen just over the last few decades that leadership has shifted and different generations in their formative years were responding to different styles of leadership. And even today, it's fascinating that, you know, of course, Gen Y are oftentimes leaders themselves, but when they're looking for leaders in their own life that they're responding to, they're looking for them to display clear communication and leaders that are approachable. I'd be keen to hear your thoughts, Grant, around, you know, how important you think this type of leadership is for Gen Y.
Well, I think it ties into our previous discussion of that personal connection as well, because I think that when we're talking about within an organization in a working context, like approachable leadership, People want that connection to the people who are leading and the people who are leading them. And if they feel that sense of connection, then they're more likely to have that trust and then to be loyal. So I think that is playing into it as well. But additionally, I think there are a few other things too. Like in this culture that has often glorified overwork, we want to feel like our contributions count. So I think no one wants to feel part of just a machine that's just kind of, they're just a cog in a big machine. People want to feel like, well, does what I'm doing actually matter? So I think leaders who can genuinely communicate that and make people feel valued are the ones who are doing well and attracting and retaining staff. So I think, you know, something comes to mind. Also, I think in a global world that feels like, again, it's just ever expanding, there's so much complexity. I think people want to feel known, and they want to know and be known. So I think there's a few elements there which, again, just bring us back to the personal connections. And so, yeah, it wasn't a surprise to me that the Gen Ys were saying that when they're looking, things they're looking for in leaders are, you know, being approachable, that clear communication. I mean, to an extent, those things are common across the generations, and I think we found there was some common threads there, right? Mm. But I think when you add in the fact that where they're at in their career stage, the Gen Ys in their 30s and early 40s, they're still looking to grow and develop in their career. So those personal connections help them to do those things, to continue to grow and to develop.
Yeah, absolutely. It reminds me actually of an article that I had written over a year ago, I think now. It's on the McCrindle website, about some of the differences between Gen Y and Gen Z, mainly with regards to the workforce. And it was interesting to see, you know, similar to what we've explored in this study, like the differences and how Gen Z in those key new years to the workforce are looking for career progression and training. And even in this latest study, it was Gen Z self-identifying that they're the generation who want and need more regular praise, as well as constructive feedback and, you know, conversations about career progression. But I think about, well, what I wrote in this article was, yes, it's absolutely important to give Gen Z these things, but in that pursuit, don't forget about Gen Y, or don't forget about older generations or more established workers, because they still need praise and constructive feedback and conversations about career progression, maybe not as regularly or as often as someone who's newer to the workforce. But I feel like that's also playing into that leadership, where great leaders don't forget about different generations or more established workers, but they, you know, they think about other people. And I'd be keen, Grant, to hear if you feel the same, if you think that's important. You're a leader within this team, and, you know, you're a Gen Y as well. Is there anything else you feel like leaders, you know, need to keep in mind when they've got Gen Y team members, in terms of keeping them engaged with the work they're doing and, you know, fulfilled at work?
Yeah, well, firstly, it's a bit sobering to hear you say the words Gen Y and older leaders in the same, or like older generations in the same breath, But yes, Gen Ys are not the new kids on the block anymore.
Mm.
So I think what we see consistently through different studies we do on different topics, this theme of seeking transparency and authenticity. Mm. And I think transparency, people have seen that when that hasn't existed, when things haven't been transparent, where decisions have been made in kind of back rooms by faceless people, and seen that felt like, actually, no, that's not how we want things to be done. That leaves a kind of a very bitter taste in people's mouths. So I think it's a response to that. And so I think the Gen Y leader, like we've many of the kind of politicians being elected now are, you know, starting to belong to Gen Y. And I think kind of emblematic of a bit of a shift there in the type of the way things are done, kind of a new style of doing things, embracing technology to that end. So again, being kind of having that personal following online and just sharing your life with people and people following. I think there's some, I think of people who've been leading that no matter what your politics. I think people like, name escapes me right now, but I want to say AOC. No, who's?
Yes, I know who you're talking about.
Yes.
Yep. I know her as AOC as well.
Yes.
In the US.
Yes. I think people know. So
okay. Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez.
Yep. Also known as AOC. So I think
yes.
She is a I'm going to get this wrong now, but I think she's a member of the Congress, I think, in the US.
Yeah.
And anyways, she's I suppose an example of one of the new breed of kind of politicians, but I think and again, we could debate her politics, and I have an interest in politics, as you know. So we can debate that, but I think that aside, just the approach is much more kind of crowdfunded and kind of trying to generate that groundswell, building those personal interactions. And I think that is, you know, that is actually typical of kind of a more Gen Y approach to leadership, where you are trying to leverage those personal connections. You're trying to do things in a way that's more transparent, and then demanding that of others too, that transparency. So I think that is something that we do see in Gen Y leaders. And for those who are leading Gen Ys, that's going to win you trust if you are open and transparent about decisions and how things are made. And I think clear communication is always important. But again, it's help, people can then make their own decisions, prioritize a lot more easily if they understand the situation. So being able to communicate clearly is going to help in that regard. So, I mean, those are a couple of quick reflections, Ash, but you're pretty good at this stuff too. I don't know if you have anything you want to add.
Yeah, I totally agree about the transparency piece, and even how we've grown up with viewing Mark Zuckerberg as a bit of an icon, and, you know, some of those new billionaires in terms of CEOs and transformative leaders, where it's like, oh yeah, I'd love to, like, they have their own social media pages, and it's almost like we've got these new expectations of leaders. Like you said, they're not locked away making decisions, but they're accessible and they've got that personality. And yeah, I think that has shaped our generation. I think it's shaping the generations to come after us as well. And yeah, that accountability, that transparency, even Brené Brown's work around not being that upfront leader who has to know all the answers, but being vulnerable and leading with empathy. I think that's things that we've seen that we appreciate as a generation from the leaders that we are responding to. And hopefully, you know, that points to more of our probably like human behavior. I think every generation wants empathetic leaders, not just Gen Y, or transparent leaders or authentic ones. But I think we're kind of been the generation to come through and see a bit of a shift in that regard and have expectations around it. So it's great time to be alive, great generation, I think, to be a part of, and really value your insights, Grant. You do a lot of this advisory work for our clients. You help them to, you know, you're at the real strategic end of some of these conversations with clients of the projects that you've already mentioned in the podcast, around helping them understand what demographic or insights they're looking for and how they can achieve that through our research services. And I feel like that's really come through in the podcast today. So thank you very much for joining us and for the chat. And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, including this latest Generations Defined report and the subsequent infographics that are going to come out of it, you can subscribe to the podcast to find out more. You can follow us on social media, or you can head to McCrindle.com for all of our other public work. So as always, thank you again for listening, and bye for now.